Let's quickly close our eyes before I jump into the word. Yeah, maybe just open up your hearts, open up your, just stretch out your hands. If you want to create a barrel, you do that. I mean, like Bo always says, there's always a good time to drink, always. So let's just take a drink of his goodness. You at home there, drink with us. A drink of his love, his healing, his provision, his grace. Lord, we love you. Thank you for this morning, Lord Jesus. Thank you for the Spirit of truth. And Father, right now, we declare in this morning that as we listen to your word, as we follow your instructions, as we worship your name, Father, we are partnering with heaven. We are partnering with the inheritance of the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Sure, it's really been good so far this morning. I'm reminded as we were worshiping this morning, those of you at home, I honestly believe you've had an incredible time so far. But I was reminded of there's a word, or someone once said that someone with an experience is never at the mercy of someone with an argument. You know, and I think it's so important for us to understand, if we experience God, if we experience his goodness, as we experience testimonies about the goodness of God, and as we worship and we experience his, literally his presence upon us, body, soul, and spirit. I mean, no one can talk you out of this. And that is what I love about corporate worship. That's what I love about being with my brothers and sisters in the faith. I mean, I just love being in the stillness and in the quietness of just me and God. But I so love being with my brothers and my family. I'm telling you, nothing replaces it. I've had some incredible times in the church world over the last 13, 14 years. Mostly great encounters, some maybe not so great encounters. There were times where I could have taken offense. Had an argument of, you know what, it's just me and Jesus. But I'm telling you right now, every single time the Lord just reminds me about how important it is for brothers and sisters to fellowship together, to partner in faith, and together we will accomplish great things for the kingdom. So, yeah, it's great to see everyone here this morning. I'm going to jump into a scripture here, three scriptures. 1 Samuel 16, verse 7 and 13. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. He's talking about Saul here. The Lord does not look at the things. Oh, no, sorry. He was looking at the brothers of David. Sorry. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearances, but the Lord looks at the heart. So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Acts 13:22 says, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. And last one, 1 Samuel 18. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but had departed from Saul. So he sent David away from him and gave him command over 1,000 men. And David led the troops and in their campaigns. In everything he did, he had great success because the Lord was with him. David, a man after God's heart. David, a man where God says, I was with this man. I was with David. Now, just to take you back a month ago, I was standing there and Bill came to me after the church service and said, Yanni, would it be okay if you maybe come this Sunday and share a word? And I was just like, yes, definitely. I mean, come on, to talk about the Lord, I love it. And while he was talking to me, there was suddenly I had this encounter with the Lord. He was speaking and it was almost as if I went into a trance. It was almost as if in 5 seconds or 10 seconds, it felt like the Lord spoke to me about an hour long. He spoke to me clearly and so deliberately about the life of David and the seasons that David went through in his life and why at the end of David's life, God could say, David, a man after my own heart. A man that heart's position was always positioned toward the Father. Good. You know, obeying Him, loving Him, worshiping Him. And I want to share what the Lord spoke to me that morning. Now, first of all, we need to understand David is quite a big thing in the Bible. David's name is used the second most mentioned name in the Bible after Jesus, if you didn't know that. The second most, more than Abraham, Moses, Isaac, I mean everyone, Paul, is the second most used name in the Bible. And we need to understand God is the one that wrote this phenomenal book. Everything in there is purposefully put in there for our benefit and for us to connect with Him, for us to worship Him, and for us to release another kingdom, to bring heaven to earth. That is why this book was written, so that we can have direct access to God and see, God, what are you saying to us as a church? And what are you saying to us through the lives of these people that was in the Bible? Now, the one thing we should always understand is we do not put people on a pedestal. We do not worship people. We do not worship David. He's mentioned a lot. In the Jewish culture, David is unique. We went to Israel a year and a half ago. Phenomenal experience. Go there. You will get whacked by the presence of God. I promise you right now. We had so many powerful encounters. Anyways, I don't want to go there. But the thing is, why do we... So the question is, why do we learn from people in the Bible? If we don't worship them, we don't put them on a pedestal. God has put these people there so we can look at their lives and see how did they navigate through different seasons, through different challenges, and how did they keep the faith? You know, what was their heart condition? How did they view God? How did they worship God? When there were times of success, when there were times of failures, how did they keep the faith? So we need to understand, when we talk about the seasons of life, I mean, I know there was a time where I didn't like people talking about spiritual seasons. There was almost like, you know, I was like, no, man, I don't agree with that. I'm just in one season, and it's the glory season. I'm just in one season, and it is fruitful. You know, you are not going to tell me about a wilderness season. I will not partner with that. And I was always so against this until I had a wilderness season in my life. Who understands what I'm talking about? Huh? I mean, I was riding the glory wave. God was good. People getting saved. People getting healed. I mean, it's just ridiculous. I'm like, yes, Lord. I'm like, come on. We're going to take the nations. Phenomenal seasons. And then sometimes things changes. And God tests you. He prunes you. He works in you. And you need to understand, how are you now going to navigate the fact that suddenly people reject you? Suddenly people resist you. How do you work through those times in your life? Now, looking into David's life, and I want to say this before we go into that, the seasons, or some people call it the cycles or the patterns. I don't want to create the theology, so let's make it very clear. I don't want to create the theology about this is a season where I'm at. But we sometimes need to understand where God has positioned us and what is the lessons and the character and the power that He wants to release over us. Why am I here at this moment? Was it because of mistakes, decisions that I made? Or is it purposefully there because God has got something bigger planned for you? Sometimes you find yourself in a season because of the decisions you made. And sometimes you find yourself in a season because you're in the middle of God's plan for your life and He's got greater things in store. And we need to understand this. So what's very important is, I've seen people create an identity because of the season they find themselves in. I've seen people go through a season of struggle, and it became their identity. It became their crutch almost. Yeah. It became like, this is just who I am. You know, I'm struggling financially. 20 years later, I'm still struggling financially. I'm always sharing the next testimony of how God came through, and, you know, we never get past that. And it almost becomes your identity that, listen, I'm the person with this disease, or I'm the person with this shortcoming in my life, or this speaking impediment. Is that a word? Yeah. Speaking, it sounds like that's the right thing to put together. It's Afrikaans, Janni. So I guess Janni, so Afrikaans is going to come. So this is me, you know, speaking English under the anointing is completely different than me speaking normal English. So the thing is, I've seen it. I've seen people never moving past something that happened in their life. They've been stuck there for 20 years and 30 years, and they just say, listen, this is my cross to bear. Meanwhile, God is standing there. He's like, listen, come on, boy. Come on, my child. Come on, son. You can move on from this. So, I mean, I'm reminded of John 5, where Jesus came to the bath from Bethesda, the bath of, how do you say it in English? Bethesda. Bethesda is almost the same as the Afrikaans one. He was walking there, and there's this lame guy. And this lame guy has been lying there for 38 years. That season has been going on for 38 years. And Jesus walks past him and he's asking a question that sounds ridiculous almost. Do you want to get well? I mean, this guy's lying there. He's like, hello. 38 years. I've been here. I've been trying to get into the bath or the pool. I've been trying to get into the pool for 38 years. And you're asking me, do I want to get well? Can you not see how motivated I am? 38 years I've been sitting here and trusting. And Jesus asked the question, do you want to get healed? And I believe at that moment, there must have been a divine understanding that, listen, this has become my identity. I'm the lame guy sitting at the pool wanting to get healed. Please, people, help me. Please, people, provide for me. Please, people, never once did he decide I'm going to stand up and make something of my life. This is just who I am. And it's so easy. And as Christians, and I've seen this, and I mean, some people like Bo has been in ministry for 40 years, forever almost. But you've been in ministry for long. I mean, I'm sure they've seen so many situations where people struggle to get past this. They've struggled to get past their, whether it's their sin or their crutch or their disease, and it becomes their identity. And so when we talk about the seasons, I believe God's wanting to remind people today, to motivate people today, to encourage people today, to rise up above where you are at this moment, to not accept it as your identity, to not accept and say, this is just who I am, this is how I'm going to walk out my walk with God forever, because this is not how it's supposed to be. We are supposed to feast with the King. Amen. In every situation. Now, when we look at David's life, there's different seasons in David's life, but the Lord revealed to me four different ones that I want to talk about quickly. I want to share some of my own testimonies or stories in there. The first one was the season of obscurity and preparation. You can almost say it was the season of sowing. Now, this is the season. See, David was a shepherd boy. Now, being a shepherd boy was like, in today's terms, you would almost say it's like the son of the house working in the garden or walking the dogs or mowing the lawn. It wasn't a big thing, you know, to be the shepherd boy. Now the most important person in the Jewish culture, in the Israelite culture, is coming to visit their house, the prophet Samuel. Everyone gets invited except David. David, you need to mow the lawn while the most important person in the nation is coming to our house. Now just think about the rejection, the humiliation, just the offense that someone like David could have taken because the most important person is coming. David knew who Samuel was. He was a worshiper of God. I'm sure that he studied Samuel, and I'm sure that he heard about the rumors and the stories of how much Samuel was obedient to God and the great quest and the great testimonies of Samuel. And now Samuel is coming to his home, and everyone is invited except the worshiper of the home. Everyone. And here Samuel comes, and he's coming with a word from the Lord. The Lord just told Samuel, listen, one of Jesse's son is the next king of Israel. He didn't have a name. He didn't see a face. He didn't get a vision of his David standing in front of him or the name David. He just knew Jesse. So he were obedient to almost a partial word of knowledge. And that's why when we get a word of knowledge from the Lord, even if it doesn't make sense, you act on it. The Lord will reveal more. So Samuel was going towards Jesse's house, and he's going through all the sons, and it's like, we all know the story. Listen, not one of them is the king. And they called David. And David was anointed in front of his whole family as the king. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David like never before. Now, we need to understand that sometimes the small, mundane things we do when no one is watching, is equally important as the great and phenomenal things we do in public. The giant we slay in private is almost equally, or if not more important, than the giant we slay in public. It is possible for people to accidentally slay a giant in public and then to see their life go down from there. They never had that preparation. They never had that personal breakthrough with the Lord. And David was in a time of obscurity, a time of preparation, a time of sowing. No one was watching. No one knew how much his heart was positioned towards the Father, how much his heart was full of purity and holiness and adoration towards an almighty King. He was literally tending the sheep, worshiping the King, and creating a spirit of excellence upon his life. He started playing the harp in obscurity. I mean, he was playing for the sheep probably. I mean, he had an audience of sheep. You know, he played for them. I don't know how it, the breakthrough the sheep had, you know, more wool or more fruitfulness. I don't know. But he played for the sheep and he became excellent with a normal talent. And that talent gave him access to the palace. That thing that was unimportant, that thing where he didn't play even for his family, probably, I assume, because he wasn't even invited to the most important gathering of the family, the event that this family would have been speaking about forever. I don't get invited. So how do you respond to rejection? How do you respond to disappointment? And I think this is a key that we as Christians need to understand. When we struggle with disappointment and when we struggle with rejection, the enemy has got you exactly where he wants you. The way you respond to rejection is also the way you will respond to the praises of man. The two are linked together. If you can respond to rejection by keeping your faith, keeping your identity, standing strong and strengthening yourself in the Lord, you will probably be able to handle the praises of people because you would know that you can give that back. The glory you can give back to God. Because you know how to even respond to rejection. And David had to understand that even as a young boy, when no one took him seriously, it was important for him to grow in the Lord even when people didn't believe in him. I mean, he went to the army when Goliath was there. Even his brothers questioned the motives of his heart. That's true. They said there was evil in his heart. Even his brothers, are they not supposed to know him? It just proves to you how many times what's really going on inside of you, people out there is not aware of. That struggles or that successes, that breakthrough, that level of faith, how many times the people out there has got no idea what's happening. They've got no idea how God is preparing you. Yet one day you will be launched into a season of fruitfulness. I remember when I just got saved. This is the power pause. So you can think about what was said. I remember when I got saved. I was in the world drinking, partying. I was a typical Afrikaans student, drinking brandy, you know, going out to the pubs. That was just the typical life I had and everyone that I knew. And I got radically saved. I mean, it was just, for me, I couldn't believe that the one day I was like this and the other day I was like this. I mean, I remember people running away from me that knew me beforehand. I would speak to them. I would find them in the shopping mall. And I couldn't help but speak about what happened. And they would literally turn around and run away. It happened a couple of times. I would run after them. You know, I was like, Jesus loves you. You know, I was crazy. And I remember getting saved. And the first thing that I realized is that there's so much I want to learn. There's so much of God and His goodness. And I suddenly realized how to look towards women, how to treat women, how to worship God, how to treat my father, how to be excellent in my work and everything I do. Everything changed in an instant. It was a powerful repentance moment, powerful deliverance. And I couldn't help but just give everything over to God. And I remember someone giving me a CD when I got saved, literally that next week, about 60 sermons of Bill Johnson. And it was in 2007. I'm so thankful for that sermon. So I grew up eating and drinking from the culture of revival, from the culture of the supernatural. While I was this, I was part of a church planting discipleship movement. So I had both. And I just loved it. I just loved seeing God work. And I was so hungry. Everything I could get, every book I could get, I would go to the church offices and irritate the people and ask questions and say, pray for me. Just lay hands on me. Come on, let's talk about God. And it was a season where I prepared myself. I was driving around all over. I was a sales rep at that moment. So I was driving around in my car all over the Western Cape. And I would just put on sermons and listen to it over and over. I would drive like around the clients, you know, and come back just to make sure the sermon is finished, you know. So I was listening to sermons and being paid for it. It was phenomenal. You know? I was driving, listening to God. And it was a season where I was literally like just allowing God to love on me and allowing my heart to be positioned. And that is what is important. That is what we can learn from David. Always positioning his heart, no matter the season, towards the Father. Looking past all the struggles, looking past all everything other people said and other people did, and always maintaining a pure heart. Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And I remember and going over to David. So from that season, he went into a season of favor and early promotion. A season of favor. I don't know who has encountered a season in their lives where there was so much favor, so much promotion, so much fruitfulness, you couldn't keep up with it. I mean, you were going, everything just happened so easily. The people you pray for, they get healed. The people you minister to, they get saved. You know, people sow into your life, you get promoted, your family loves you, your neighbors love you. You're just getting so much love, and you're giving love, and everything is just, I mean, come on. I mean, don't tell me there's people in the wilderness. They need to renew their mind. If you're in this season, you're looking at people in the wilderness, you're like, listen, buddy, you need to get out of there. It's good on this side. You need to get on this side. The promised land, milk and honey. Come on, why are you still there? Cross the Jordan. I mean, I was in this season. I got saved and we started to minister, plant a church. I went to schools, universities, different churches. I mean, even the Enoch Church allowed me to preach there. And we would go there and we would deliver the word and people were like, yeah. And it was crazy. It was just an incredible season. And for a couple of years, me and my wife, we just saw so much breakthrough. I loved the ministry. I loved sharing the gospel. Even if there was a little bit of resistance, I was like, come on, that's only making me stronger. But it was such a phenomenal season. And then one day, my wife and I, we were in full-time ministry now. We were just praising the Lord and sitting in our quiet time. And the Lord spoke to my wife and he spoke to me exact same time. I want you to move out of ministry into the marketplace. I want you to go back into the marketplace out of full-time occupational ministry. We're all in ministry. Okay. Out of the food, you're not going to be paid by the church anymore. I was like, hallelujah. That's a good thing. Anyways. So suddenly, in a moment, we were in unity, my wife and I. It came out of sort of nowhere. And we spoke to a couple of our friends that loves God, that loves us. And they said, Yanni, we can agree with you. We see it in your life. We can agree. And suddenly, in a moment, we shifted out of a season of abundance into an incredible, challenging time. Incredible. People questioning our motives. People questioning our calling. People coming and saying, listen, you're going to miss your calling. You're going to miss your destiny. You're going to miss it completely. And we are just like crying. And my wife and I, we're like, listen, we just want to obey God. We just want to love God and we want to be obedient to Him. And it was such a challenging time. People phoning us from all over the country, questioning us, and going from preaching 4 or 5 times a week at different places to not preaching at all. For more than a year, people suddenly questioning your motives. And in the quiet place, you and me and my wife, we're just like, Lord, we are so much more in love with you. We believe so much more in the church today than we did a year ago. But yet people are suddenly questioning and suddenly looking different at you. Why is that? Going into the marketplace, it was a struggle. It was a sort of like a wilderness season, if I can call it that. But in that season, we kept the faith. And in that season, I started to believe more and more on the calling of the church. I started to believe more and more that God wants us to be part of the church. That's why I will always advocate and encourage people to be part of a congregation, to be part of a group of believers. Because even when we were out there, even when we were in a season of the desert, if I can call it like that, feeling rejected, if I can call it like that, from certain people in the church community, I still felt like I love them more because they're doing God's work. They don't necessarily understand everything we're going through, but we're going to keep the faith and we're going to stand strong. And David went into a season of pruning and waiting. It's a season of testing and trials. David went into the season of, remember I said when we went through the season of favor and early promotion, just like that, David went from slaying David, I almost forgot about this, slaying Goliath, he went into the palace. Oh, before that, he played the harp in the palace. Oh, no, the harp's like this. He played a harp. So David went from preparing himself suddenly into a season of promotion, fruitfulness. He's in the palace. He's dining with the king. He's marrying the king's daughter. He slayed Goliath. Everyone knows his name. Everyone is praising him. Everyone is singing. David is killing tens of thousands and Saul was only killing thousands. So he went from being an unknown person to suddenly being the most sung about or sang about person in the whole of Israel. And people thinking, listen, this David, he's probably the next king. And he experienced so much favor. And this went on for quite a long time. And suddenly Saul got jealous. Suddenly Saul knew that, listen, he is the next anointed king. And because of that, David went into that wilderness season, that season of pruning and waiting and testing and trials. And what is incredible is, do you know how many of the Psalms that we are reading today, the Psalms that is encouraging us, that's lifting our faith, that is connecting us with our Father in heaven, you know how many of those psalms were written by David in the wilderness where he had to strengthen himself in the Lord? I mean, this was an incredible challenging time. He had to run away from his wife. He was literally, thousands of people wanted to kill him. The king that he literally adored and he literally wanted to do everything to please the king wanted to kill him. I mean, even his own followers, the people he raised up, the people he discipled, they turned on him in some certain seasons and even wanted to kill him. That is how intense the season was. But David kept on believing. He kept on strengthening himself in the Lord. And that is so important. I want us to understand, when you find yourself in a season like this, what I've found, and if you look towards people's testimony, a lot of ministers of the gospel, a lot of ministries were birthed in these seasons. A lot of businesses were birthed in these seasons. A lot of marriages were birthed in these seasons. Because in these seasons, God can actually get to your heart. I remember the most incredible thing for me when I was in a wilderness season was my mom passed away when I was 14 and I never dealt with it. She had cancer. And I never dealt with it. And now while we were in this wilderness season, suddenly my wife gets cancer. And I'm like, okay, people are questioning our motives just to love on God and to minister towards people. Now my wife's got cancer. You know, I'm starting a new business. Everything is just tough and hard. It was challenging. And in that season, I could see how strong my wife was. And she got healed and she's 100% now. But it was a challenging season. And in that season, a business was birthed. In that season, we came to Journey of Grace. And we met new incredible people in that season. And David had to go through that. And what we can learn from that is that in those type of seasons, if we keep on standing strong, if we keep on connecting with other believers, we will rise up from that and probably we will rise up stronger. Yeah. That is quite unique. And the last one, the season of promises fulfilled is the season of reaping. Now, what we see in David's life, after he went through all of these trials. Now, we need to understand, sometimes you can have four seasons in one day. You need to understand that. When we talk about a season, it doesn't mean for 4 years or 2 months. You can go through different spiritual battles and spiritual warfare in one moment, in one day. You can go through a wilderness fight in the morning. and you can get your breakthrough and your reaping in the afternoon. So we need to understand that when we drove here, we literally encountered four seasons. You know, sun, rain. It was incredible. And it can happen in your life spiritually. And the seasons of promises fulfilled, what is incredible is that is probably the season where you need to be more aware of God than any other season, because there's more eyes looking onto you. There's more people looking towards you. There are more people thinking, listen, we can learn from you. You've suddenly, maybe you've gotten your breakthrough, you've gotten a new ministry, a business, promotion, whatever it might be, children in your family, kids are looking at mom and dad. We need to understand that this season of reaping, the season of fruitfulness, promises fulfilled, the prophetic words, you see it happening and manifesting in your life, is equally as important to remain in love with God, to remain seated in that foundation. I want to end off, how did David make it work? And I want to just list five things quickly. Psalm 18 verse 1 says, I love you, O Lord, my strength. The first one was, he remained a true worshiper no matter the season. No matter the season, he remained a worshiper and a lover of God. Number two, overcoming rejection and disappointment. We did speak about that. He was able to overcome it in every season. And he was rejected and ridiculed in every single one of them. And we need to be okay with that. A lot of people think when you get rejected, you get disappointed. People think we're missing God, but it's not the case. It's not the case. How we respond to that. Third one, handling the praises and the applause of man. In every season, David knew how to handle the praises and the applause of man. Fourth one, he stayed faithful and he stayed full of faith. Faithful, which you can also spell full of faith. You can do that if you want to, okay? Yeah. Full of faith. He remained full of faith always. Keeping your first love. He kept his first love. In the book of Revelation, we read that the church literally lost their first love. David kept his first love. Even through the mistakes he made, the struggles he made. 2 Timothy 4:7 says, Paul writes here, I fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept my faith. Let's close our eyes. There was a lot said right now about seasons and cycles and how to navigate through this. But right now, I want you to allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you. Just forget about you at home, everyone at home. Just allow the Holy Spirit right now. Close your eyes. Forget about the kids. Forget about what's happening around you. Forget about work. Allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you right now. What is He wanting to say to you today? The position of your heart, the love of your life. Where are you right now? I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I've kept the faith. Jesus said, if I return, will I find faith in the earth? And I want to encourage everyone right now. I want to speak life over everyone. So if you want to raise your hand, everyone at home, I'm going to speak and declare prophetically over your life right now. I want to declare right now that disappointments and rejections will be broken over your life in the name of Jesus Christ right now. What other people said about you, or what even what you thought other people said about you, that lies will be broken and declared null in the name of Jesus. I declare it over your life right now. We declare the freedom of Jesus, that in the season you find yourself in right now, that you will be a worshiper of God, a lover of Jesus, full of faith. I declare it right now that faith will be restored. Where people lost hope, I felt so strongly that because of these things, people have lost hope. They've lost their faith almost. And I declare right now that restoration and increase will happen over your life in the name of Jesus Christ right now. Just receive it by faith. So Father God, I want to thank you that as you looked upon David, and you said, David, a man after my own heart. Lord, I want to thank you that you look upon this church, as you look upon us as individuals, men and women, and Lord, that you love us. You love our heart. You love our praises. You love our bodies. You love everything about us, Jesus. And Father, I declare right now that false identities will be broken off of people in the name of Jesus Christ, and that you will restore our heavenly identity, our prophetic identities. Lord, I declare it over us in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, may we rise up like David did. May we walk in a season of fruitfulness, in a season of abundance, and in a season of prophecies fulfilled. I declare it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
That was an awesome word. Come on. Fantastic. You know that David, it's in 1 Samuel 16, David had a resume. And the last, it was six pieces to the resume. And the last thing said about him in the resume is that the Lord was with him. And that's what makes it all possible. Our faithfulness, our courage, stamina, or all that stuff. You know, it's not possible without Jesus. Isn't that? It's just, yeah, all the discipline in the world. No matter how early you get up, how late you stay up. All the things that we know we get to do, we can't without him. You know, that's really the best part of the equation. I mean, thank God for gifts. Thank God for character. Thank God for resources. Thank God for relationships. Thank God for the body. Thank God for community. But thank God for God. Yeah. Because, hey, without him, we can't do any of it. We really can't. And that's the best news of all. You might be out there feeling like, wow, I agree with Yanni, but man, I tell you, I believe everything he has said, but I just seem to come short every time. We do come short, but he doesn't. We do fall, but we get back up because he gets us back up. If you're out there, and bottom line is we need Jesus, all of us. Our faith and trust is in him and him alone. It really, really is. And I think there's some people watching and you don't know Jesus. Maybe you're like the prodigal son, you've run from the father's house for whatever reason. Maybe you've never been born again. Maybe you've never repented. Maybe you've never put your faith and trust in just Jesus. It's not Jesus plus everything else. It's just Jesus. Yeah. Jesus alone. Faith in Christ alone lays the foundation for everything else to work. So I want to pray for you. If that's you, if you're watching and you need to get right with Jesus, he's right there with you. His goodness, his grace, his mercy, he's there with you. You just have to say yes. Just give him that faith that you've given to so many other things. That's led to disappointment after disappointment. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If you just repeat this after me, say, Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. That's right. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. When he went to that cross, he paid that incredible price. He did it for me. His blood was shed so that I could live. And today, I confess my sin. I ask you to forgive me from all my sin. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Breathe your breath of life on the inside of me. Sit on the throne of my heart and be the Lord of my life from this day forward. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me so much that you would die for me. And thank you that right now I get to live with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, this has been an awesome morning. And guess what? It doesn't have to stop, because it's not just about what's going on in this room. It's not what's just going on out in your lounge or wherever you might be, but it's the journey. It's about the everywhere, everyone, all the time presence that's been paid for no matter where we are and who we are. So anyway, we love you. Been fantastic. Let's just give a praise to Jesus one more time out there in here. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. You guys have just a great Sunday. God bless. God bless you. Thank you.